from the summit of Sinir and Hermon, from the dens of lions, from the mountains of leopards. You have made my heart beat faster, my sister, my bride. You have made my heart beat faster with the single glance of your eyes, with the single strand of your necklace. How beautiful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much better is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your oils than all kinds of spices. Your lips, my bride, drip honey. Honey and milk are under your tongue. And the fragrance of your garments is like the fragrance of Lebanon. A garden locked is my sister, my bride. A rock garden locked. A spring sealed up. Your shoots are an orchard of pomegranates, with choice fruits, henna with nard plants, nard and saffron, calamus and cinnamon, with all the trees of frankincense, myrrh and aloes, along with all the finest spices. You are a garden spring, a well of fresh water, and streams flowing from Lebanon.
Awake, O north wind, and come, wind of the south. Make my garden breathe out fragrance. Let its spices be wafted abroad. May my beloved come into his garden and eat its choice fruits.
I have come into my garden, my sister, my bride. I have gathered my myrrh along with my balsam. I have eaten my honeycomb and my honey. I have drunk my wine and my milk. Eat, friends, drink, and imbibe deeply, O lovers. You may be seated. In verse 7, we see love's viewpoint. In his eyes, she was perfect, without blemish. Was she? Certainly not. She was beautiful for sure, but no one is perfect. And even if her body was perfect, a thing strived for, but never attained, the man married to her would soon discover that she wasn't perfect in other ways. Blemishes come in more than physical form. In fact, I've got a pretty good idea that a lot of those women with outstanding beauty are not women that I would want to be married to. Character defects matter more than physical ones. And I'm confident that some of you, or those of you that are married, know what I'm talking about. I mean, what do you do after the wedding? When you realize that the person you married has flaws. Sometimes they do things that are really ugly. And the truth is, it goes both ways. You do some ugly things too. But even if she wasn't perfect, you'd have never known it from listening to him. Was this just flattery? Or did he mean it when he said there, you are all together beautiful, my darling, and there's no blemish in you? I'm confident he meant it. Just as God meant it when he spoke of Christ's bride being without blemish. Paul wrote in Ephesians 5, verses 25 to 27, that Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her so that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. Here, of course, Scripture is speaking of how we will be when the Lord completes his work in our lives. 1 John 3:2 says that it is not yet appear what we shall be. Not yet. But when Jesus appears a second time to take us to himself, we shall be glorified with him. These corruptible bodies, imperfect bodies, shall have been replaced with glorious, incorruptible ones. And we will have been washed not only physically, but every which way. Our sins and imperfections shall have been done away with by the blood of Christ. It'll still be the same us, but a wonderfully perfected us that will be joined to Christ for eternity. That's them. The end game, we know, is for us to be conformed to the image of God's Son. That process won't be finished until after we die. That's when the full effect of Christ's death and resurrection will be seen and felt. But the process is underway. God is chipping away at us and fashioning us into the persons he purposes. And this daily ongoing process of actually becoming holy is what the Bible calls sanctification. Romans 8, 28, or 29 and 30 telescopes the entire process when it says this: "For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom he predestined, he also called. And these whom he called, he also justified. And these whom he justified, he also glorified." I want you to note that the word glorified is past tense. In God's eyes, you see, it's as good as done. In God's eyes, we are as good as glorified. In God's eyes, we are already seated with Christ in the heavens. And that's because we're in Christ. When God looks at us, he sees not only the blemishes and the faults, he sees not only the mess we are, but he's able to look upon us with the same favor with which he looks upon his Son. The blood of his Son cleanses us from all sin and covers our transgressions. You know, women, they spend, in this country especially, they spend a lot of money on cosmetics and stuff, not just this country, you know, to cover up those perceived blemishes. Well, God's got something better yet.
Amen.
That is the blood of Christ, which covers all of our transgressions.
Amen.
Why am I saying all this? I'm pointing out that because of our acceptance of the blood of Christ for our salvation, we are truly perfect in his sight. We are altogether beautiful. Now, we cannot take credit for that any more than a woman blessed with great natural beauty can take credit for it. This beauty was given to us as a gift of God's grace when we place our faith in Christ. Now, does this mean that the person who hasn't placed their faith in Christ isn't beautiful? No, it doesn't mean that, for they are beautiful. But I wouldn't do right by you or by God's word if I didn't point out that the love being portrayed in the song is the love between Christ and his church. This beautiful dance of love that I think we're all becoming well enamored with is one that we are meant to experience. A man and a woman, they may experience a good measure of that love outside of Christ. Many will take the song as some beautiful words about love and perhaps even learn a few tips from it. But if you want to not just read about the song, but if you want to enter into the dance and experience it for yourself, then you need to be in Christ. You understand me? In verse 8, he calls her his bride, which reinforces that the relationship we read of in the song is one of marriage or pending marriage. As I said about being in Christ, I will say again about being married. If you want to join the dance and experience the type of love portrayed in the song, you need to be ready to say your vows. This is not infatuation. This is the very thing that those waiting on marriage are hoping for. And that is the lifelong love of a fully committed partner. In verse 8, he exhorts her to come from Lebanon, to journey down from the mountains of the north where the large cats made their dwelling. Now, we should not think that she was literally up in the mountains of the Lebanon range. The song is poetry. And the mountains, oh, they spoke of the far reaches of the land. They were far away. She seems so far away from him. And he purposes to bring her from there. He calls for her to leave that place and accompany him. Where is not stated. As long as she's with him, you see, it really didn't matter. It is, of course, this way. As it says in Ephesians 2:13, we who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. When Jesus called his disciples to come with him, he didn't say where they were going. Suzanne sure never dreamed where joining herself to me would take her. Where following Jesus would take his disciples wasn't really important. All that mattered was that he would be there. Where we belong is with him. Wherever that might be. In verses 9 through 11, he praises her again. In verse 11, he spoke of the sweetness of her lips. But first in verse 9, he speaks of her effect on him. Of all the verses in the song, this one and the one to follow are the most amazing, groundbreaking to me. I mean, I understand how a single glance of her eyes could make his heart beat faster. You know, us men can understand that. What I cannot fathom is the significance behind this if the words of the bridegroom in the song are meant to portray the love of our Lord for his bride. We've got to remember that the language being used is poetic. Still, is it even possible that Jesus' love for us is such that his heart beats faster when we look his way? Could it be that he's ravished by a single glance of our eyes? I mean, are you kidding? Does he really look at us this way? Could it be that the main event is ahead, and that the love of a husband and wife in this life is just a foretaste of the relationship we were made to experience for eternity? That the love we long for is available to all by faith and is not dependent upon finding a suitable partner here on earth. Could it be that we're already loved? Again, to do justice to God's word and properly set the table, I need to point out that according to Ephesians 5, it's the church that Jesus loves and gave himself for. It is the church that he has cleansed in order that she might be presented to him in all her glory without spot or wrinkle. It is the church that makes his heart beat faster. And if you think that you're going to experience the love of the song outside the church, you're mistaken. But as part of it, his eyes will meet yours. calls us from the far country and from a life of sin to be purified and joined with him. It starts with a look. The reason the heart beats faster is because of what comes after. His eyes move down her body to her necklace. In verse 10, he declares her love to be better than wine. Why wine? Surely because it was intoxicating. If wine was intoxicating, her love was more so. If those of us who have come into relationship with God through Christ have this strange preoccupation with God, there's a reason for that. It's because his love is more valuable than anything this world can offer. And when something is that valuable, you would give anything for it. That was the point of some of Jesus' parables. When you come to understand the value of the kingdom, you'll be willing to do anything for the privilege of being a part of it. And it's the privilege that's in view in verses 12 to 15. In the song, the woman is compared to a beautiful and luscious garden which the man desires to enter and eat of its fruit. And in verse 16, she urges the wind to come and carry the scent of her garden off to him, that he might be attracted to it. The New Testament, interestingly enough, speaks of the sacrifices and prayers of the saints as being a sweet-smelling aroma, fragrance to God. If the Lord views us as his bride and intends to present us to himself without blemish, then don't you think that we should be focused on keeping ourselves beautiful for him? He, of course, is not focused on physical beauty, but on beauty of thought, word, and behavior. I mean, if Adam and Eve, you know, sought to beautifully maintain the garden they were told to care for in order that it might be pleasing to their Creator, how much more should we tend to the garden that is our lives? Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? We want to live in such a way that our lives would be a fragrant aroma to God, one that would cause him to want to join in. In verse 12, he calls her a garden locked and a spring sealed up. I mean, there's really nothing more beautiful than a well-kept garden, nor more desirable than a spring of refreshing water. Well, she was like a beautiful garden with such a spring flowing from it. And the output of such a garden is pictured in the fruits and spices mentioned in verses 13 and 14. I mean, who wouldn't be attracted to such a garden and want to enter it? But the garden is locked. It is not a public garden, but a private one. And not just anyone may enter it. He compares her to a rock garden, shooting forth an orchard of pomegranates, among other delicious fruits and spices, putting out an enticing aroma. And again, I think us men can understand the author well enough. I mean, you look at a woman, you know, bursting with beauty, and you know, as a man, you watch her. You want to take her to yourself. She's locked. In his case, she wants nothing more than to open up to him. But she cannot do this right away. There's a process to follow. That which is worth having is worth waiting for. If the consummation is delicious, as he describes in chapter 5, verse 1, so is the courtship. It's primarily the courtship that we read of in the song. a role in ensuring that she remain a virgin until the time. We must remember that there are three parties to the song, and one of them is the company of others watching this relationship unfold and blossom. They're able to rejoice with the lovers, but they too have an interest in the relationship and in seeing that things are done properly. Our African brothers and sisters tell us about how in their culture, you know, they must go to her father and brothers and negotiate a price for her. And some of them can come up right now and tell us what they had to do to get their bride. And it's an unenviable task, but a necessary one if he would have her. Not only must she unlock her garden and allow him in, the family must too. It is a tragedy today that most women are giving themselves away without requiring him to pay the price. The price of entering the garden and eating of its fruit should be a wedding ring. And if that's what it takes, a man will pay the price every time. He will. Providing, you know, what he wants is to spend the rest of his life with her and isn't just looking to satisfy his lust for one night. For a woman to be used for such a purpose, it's a tragedy and a degradation in God's sight. For she's worth more than that. This isn't that hard to grasp. And yet I wonder how we could have failed to teach it to an entire generation of young people. Several generations now. How could it now be the norm for couples to live together before marriage? You have to lay some of that on the chorus of friends and family, who should be coaching the couple in the right way and expecting certain things of them, but are failing couples in that regard. You see, to have her is a privilege, an enormous privilege, and with privilege always comes responsibility. Ladies, if he wants the privilege, then require of him that he assume the responsibilities of the woman. He must marry her and pledge to take care of her for a lifetime. And just as those African brothers and sisters will jump through those painful hoops and pay whatever price they must to get their bride, he'll pay whatever price is required if he truly wants you. The only price most guys are having to pay these days is the price of a couple dinners, some kind words, and maybe even an I love you. And it's a pittance. It's nothing. Giving yourself to a man on those terms would be like selling a Van Gogh for $100. And hear me, you're worth more than that. And you need to know it. Only you knew. How much are you worth? Well, so highly did Jesus value your love that he gave everything he had for you. He suffered, gave, and died in order to have you. And if you're seeking to measure your worth, you can measure it there. He knows and understands in a way you do not how valuable your love is, and he would weep to watch you give it away for nothing. In the prophets, God voiced his lament that his people in idol worship were giving themselves away at no cost to other lovers. And this must have been unbearable for God to watch. After he had paid so much for them, after he had invested so much in the relationship and poured blood, sweat, and tears into it, he had to watch her jump into bed some guy she just met The Israelites felt like they were getting something out of it, and they wanted to. Just as the girl. It was consensual. The woman in the song will give him her love too. But she will make him work for it first. In our Lord's case, the work has already been done. He has laid himself out for us, and he has proven his love beyond the shadow of a doubt. Furthermore, he has pledged himself for eternity to all who believe. He's placed the Holy Spirit in us to mark us as his own and as a pledge that the rest of what he's promised us will be coming. I mean, the Holy Spirit is, for all practical purposes, the wedding ring that he has placed on our hand. Jesus has paid the price to redeem us and get us for himself. And therefore, it's only right that in chapter 5, verse 1, he says that he has come into his garden. He's not taking from her. He's not using her. He has gone through the proper channels, and she has become his. The beautiful garden that's locked to other men, he holds the key to, and they rightfully enter. I am my beloved's, says the woman. She says it with joy. And he is mine. Chapter 5, verse 1 ends with these words in the New American Standard. Eat, friends, drink, and imbibe deeply, O lovers. The translators of the NIV and the ESV put these words in the mouth of the chorus of onlookers. And if this is correct, then those in attendance are assenting to the marriage and rejoicing with the couple while they exhort them to have their fill of love. It's the same sentiment we have when we see the newlywed couple off to celebrate their wedding night. I actually suspect, though, that the New American Standard is correct, and that the voice in verse 1 is the same throughout. If it's still the bridegroom speaking these words, then he is exhorting the friends who have gathered for the celebration to eat, as those gathered for weddings always do. They too are invited to enjoy life's good gifts and drink their fill. If these words are spoken by the bridegroom, then he calls all of them lovers too. And they are. You see, to celebrate and experience love is what we're all made for. And as we've learned again this morning, the love your heart yearns for is already yours in Jesus Christ. You do not need to experience marriage in this lifetime to experience the love illustrated for us in the song. We're not done yet, so please stay with us. We shall see just how much he loves us. But in the meantime, we've learned that there are two tickets we need to punch if we want to come to the dance. The first is that we need to belong to the church, the body and bride. And of course, the way you do that is by placing all your faith in Jesus and giving your heart to him. And the second is that we need to be willing to make a lifelong covenant with him. In other words, the price of having a saving relationship with Jesus is a wedding ring. It's an exchange of vows. But for those willing to pay the price of commission, something will open that exceeds our wildest dreams. I don't know if you're tracking with me through the song here. I sure hope you are.